Hello everyone, this is the fourth and final lecture for topic 5, that is the skeletal system, and we are going to learn about the appendicular skeleton here. The appendicular skeleton is made up of 126 bones. These 126 bones are 60 bones of the upper limb, 60 lower limb, 4 bones in the pectoral girdle and 2 in the pelvic girdle. The figure shows the anterior and posterior view of the human skeleton. Everything that's in greenish blue is the axial skeleton, while the rest of it, which is brownish or off-white, is the appendicular skeleton. The pectoral or the shoulder girdle is made up of 4 bones or 2 pairs of bones. The first pair is made up of the collar bones and the second pair is made up of the shoulder blades or the scapula. The clavicle articulates medially with the breastbone or the sternum and laterally with the scapula, while the scapula articulates with the clavicle at the acromioclavicular joint, and it also articulates with the head of the upper arm bone, the humerus, at the glenoid cavity. The figure shows the articulated right shoulder or the right pectoral girdle. The figure shows the superior and inferior views of the right clavicle. The clavicle is a small S-shaped bone which spans between the acromion of the scapula at its lateral acromial end and the manubrium of the sternum at its medial sternal end. Note that the clavicle appears nearly straight from an anterior view, and the S-shaped is actually best appreciated from the superior view. Functionally, the clavicle is like a brace that holds the upper limb in place away from the body. The scapula is a triangular bone with superior, lateral and medial borders. The corners of the triangle are known as the superior, lateral and inferior angles. The scapula's broad, flat surface is the body. There are two superior projections, the anterior coracoid process and the posterior acromion. The acromion forms the joint with the clavicle, known as the acromioclavicular joint. The posterior surface of the scapula has a prominent ridge called the spine of the scapula, and that is palpable as your shoulder blade. Superior and inferior to the spine are two depressions, the supraspinous and the infraspinous fossae. On the anterior surface, the body of the scapula has a broad indentation, the subscapular fossa. On its lateral surface is a shallow depression called the glenoid cavity that forms the shoulder joint with the humerus. The upper limb consists of 60 bones in the arm, the forearm, the wrist, and the hand. The only bone within the arm is the humerus. The humerus is a single long bone, and at its proximal end, it has a rounded head that articulates with the glenoid cavity of the scapula, thus forming the shoulder joint. The diaphysis of the humerus features a projection called the deltoid tuberosity, where the deltoid muscles attach. At the distal end, the humerus has two small projections called the medial and the lateral epicondyles. Distal to these are two larger condyles, the medial trochlea and the lateral capitulum. Proximal to the trochlea are indentations in the humerus where the ulna articulates, the anterior coronoid fossa and the posterior olecranon fossa. This figure shows the posterior olecranon fossa at the distal end of the humerus. The two forearm bones are the lateral radius and the medial ulna. The ulna is wide proximally and thin distally, while the radius is skinny proximally and wide distally. The proximal end of ulna has two processes, coronoid and olecranon processes, separated by a deep curve called the trochlear notch. These two processes articulate with the coronoid fossa and the olecranon fossa of the humerus. The trochlear notch articulates with the trochlea of the humerus. Distal to the coronoid process is the radial notch, which is where the radius and the ulna articulate at the proximal radio-ulnar joint. The wrist is composed of 8 short bones called carpals, arranged in 2 rows of 4 bones in each hand. These bones have been labeled individually in the figure. The carpals articulate proximally with the radius and ulna and distally with 5 long bones in the hand called the metacarpals. The metacarpals articulate distally with the fingers, which are formed from 14 long bones called phalanges. The second through fifth digits have 3 phalanges each, which are the proximal, intermediate and distal phalanges, while the thumb has only 2, a proximal and a distal phalanx. The pelvic girdle or the pelvis is formed by the fusion of 2 coxal or hip bones and the sacrum. Each coxal bone is known as a hemipelvis. 3 fused bones, the ilium, the ischium and the pubis, make up each coxal bone. The function of the pelvic girdle is to connect the lower limbs to the trunk, support the pelvic organs and transmit the weight of the trunk to the legs. The 2 coxal bones meet at the sacrum. The opening into the pelvis is known as the pelvic inlet. The ridge around the inlet is the pelvic brim. The pelvic inlet and the brim separate the superior greater pelvis from the inferior lesser pelvis. Laterally, the ilium, ischium and the pubis bones come together to form a deep socket known as the acetabulum. The acetabulum forms the hip joint with the femur. Also, where the ischium and the pubis meet, there is a large hole called the obturator foramen. In a living person, this hole stays covered with a membrane that allows only small blood vessels and nerves to pass through. The 3 bones of the pelvic girdle have the following features. Ilium is the largest of the 3 bones. Its main portion is called the body, the superior wing, known as the ala, and the ridge of the ala is called the iliac crest. The ischium is the postero-inferior pelvis. It contains the superior ischial spine and the inferior ischial tuberosity. The tuberosities are the butt bones, that means the bones that bear your weight when you sit down. The anterior portion of the pelvis is formed by the pubis or the pubic bone. The pubis consists of a body and the bodies of the 2 pubic bones meet anteriorly at a fibrocartilage pad called the pubic symphysis. Anatomically, the pelvis shows gender differences. The female pelvis is smaller, smoother and lighter due to smaller body size. Also, the female pelvis shows adaptations for childbearing that support the weight of the fetus and also allow the passage of the newborn through the pelvic outlet during childbirth. A skeleton's sex can be determined based upon the differences between the male and female pelvises. Some of these distinguishing features are the shape of the pelvic inlet. It is wider and more circular in females. It is narrower in male pelvis. The ilia flare laterally in the females and do not flare so much in males. The pubic arch in females has a wider angle. It's greater than 90 degrees. In males, it is less than 90 degrees. The acetabulae are further apart in the female pelvis. In the male pelvis, they are closer together. The ischial tuberosities are everted in the female pelvis. They are inverted in the male pelvis. And the coccyx is straighter, more movable in females as compared to less movable in males. The lower limb consists of the thigh, the patella, which is the kneecap, the leg, the ankle, and the foot. The thigh contains only a single long bone, the femur. This is the heaviest, strongest bone in the body. At the proximal end, the femur has a round head that articulates with the acetabulum of the coxal bone, while at the distal end, there are 2 condyles, the lateral and the medial condyles, which articulate with the tibia in the lower leg. Distal to the femoral head is the neck of the femur, which is the weakest part of the femur and the most common location for it to fracture. The lower leg has two bones, the tibia and the fibula. The tibia is the medial and larger of the two leg bones. The fibula is thin and looks like a stick. It is lateral in position and it has absolutely no role in forming the knee joint. The ankle is composed of seven short bones called tarsals that have been labeled individually in the figure. The tarsals articulate distally with five long bones in the foot called the metatarsals. Like the bones of the fingers, the bones of the toes also consist of 14 phalanges. The second through fifth digits have three phalanges each, the proximal, the intermediate or middle, and the distal phalanges, while the big toe or the hallux has only two, a proximal and a distal phalanx. The foot bones are arranged to form three strong arches. There are two longitudinal arches, medial and lateral, and one transverse arch. These are formed by the tarsal and the metatarsal bones and supported by ligaments and tendons in the foot. This shape allows them to act in the same way as a spring, bearing the weight of the body and absorbing the shock produced during locomotion. The flexibility conferred to the foot by these arches facilitates functions such as walking and running. This slide and the next one summarize all the 206 bones in the adult human skeleton. Next, we are going to learn about joints or articulations. The functions of articulations are to hold bones together and to provide mobility, that means the ability to move the bones. Classification of joints is done in two ways, based on their function and on their structure. Functionally, joints are classified by the amount of motion that they allow. There are three functional classes of joints: synarthrosis, which means immovable joints. Examples are sutures. Amphiarthrosis, which means joints that allow some motion, example pubic symphysis, and diarthrosis, which are freely movable joints, for example knee joint. Structurally, joints are classified by the type of connecting elements found between the bones. There are also three structural joint classes. The first one is fibrous joints, which consist of bones joined by short collagen fibers. Most fibrous joints allow no motion and therefore are synarthrosis. The second class is cartilaginous joints. As their name implies, they consist of bones united by the cartilage. And most cartilaginous joints allow some motion and therefore are amphiarthrosis. The third class are synovial joints, which have a true joint cavity that makes them diarthrosis. There are three types of fibrous joints. Sutures, present in the skull bones, gomphosis in the joints between teeth and the sockets of mandible and maxillae, and syndesmosis, which are present in the distal end of tibia and fibula. This figure depicts fibrous joints. Cartilaginous joints have two subtypes: synchondrosis, which contain hyaline cartilage, example present in the sternocostal joint, and the second type is symphysis, which contains fibrocartilage. An example is pubic symphysis. The figures show synchondrosis and symphysis. Synovial joints are freely movable joints in which the bones are separated by a joint cavity. The articular ends of the bones are usually covered with hyaline articular cartilage that provides a frictionless surface for articulation. The joint cavity is lined by a synovial membrane made up of connective and epithelial tissues. This membrane secretes synovial fluid that fills the cavity. It reduces friction. The figure shows a synovial joint. The synovial joint is covered with a flattened fibrous sac-like structure called the bursa, which is not actually a part of the joint. Synovial joints are classified according to their structure. The structural classes are illustrated in this slide, and the names of the classes with their examples are provided here. The range of motion of a synovial joint is described in terms of an invisible axis about which the bone moves. Synovial joints are classified according to the number of planes of motion in which the bones can move around this axis. The classes have been combined with the structural classes in the next 6 slides. Bones are subject to various inflammatory conditions. Bursitis is the inflammation of the bursa, tendonitis is the inflammation of the tendon sheath, arthritis is the inflammation of the joints. There are several types of arthritis, and this is one of the most crippling diseases in the US. Osteoarthritis is the most common age-related arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune disorder. Autoimmune means when the body's own immune cells or soldier cells attack self tissues, that is tissues of the body. Arthritis caused by the deposition of uric acid crystals, which are toxic waste products of the body, is known as gouty arthritis. This arthritis can usually be brought under control with diet. Skeletal changes occur throughout life. In addition to the normal primary and secondary curvatures of the vertebral column, there are also some abnormal spinal curvatures. Scoliosis is a sideways curve of the spine. Kyphosis is an outward curve of the spine in the upper back, while lordosis is an inward curve of the spine in the lower back. Osteoporosis is known as the bone thinning disease, which affects both men and women in the old age. It has more drastic effect in women after menopause. It makes bones fragile and makes them susceptible to fractures. The figure shows osteoporosis in women. What are the effects of aging on the skeletal system? In general, the bone density decreases. This is because the osteoblasts are not working as efficiently, so bone matrix repair and maintenance is not as efficient. Bones become more fragile, they are prone to fractures, bone loss would cause deformity, the loss of height, there might be pain in the joints, stiffness, there would also lead to loss of teeth.